I told you about the three powers we have within ourselves. One is the power of desire, that is on the left hand side, and the another power of action, which is on the right hand side, and the central power, which is the power of our image. Also, I told you about the centers that we have. The lowest center is below the Kundalini, which is responsible for our innocence. When this center gets disturbed, then our innocence is also. This is a very, very important center for sati. It plays a very vital role in your evolution. Whatever you have done before, you have done now, to spoil the awakening of Kundalini, or you can say to spoil the Sushumna, the central part, is all recorded in that Kundalini itself. But the recording takes place because this center, which is at the end, which is innocent, receives all the information from this conditioning line, the left side. It receives all the information and it records, just like a tape recorder. So the Kundalini is aware of the mistakes that are committed by you personally, by the society, by the conditioning of the your speaking, by all sorts of things that you have done so far, by which you have tried to hamper the path of your realization. So this is the path, the central path, which is very important for you. But that should not give you a gift. One thing I must tell you, when I speak, you should not take me that seriously. Because that's the worst thing that happens to you, that you start developing a gift and then the realization becomes very difficult. So please do not develop any guilt when I say something, or just start pondering, oh, I have done this mistake and that mistake. Because I'm talking of first and last time, as I said it. And today is the first time, I would say again, to begin with, that I'm talking of ocean of love. If you were so perfect, there was no need to have surgery. There was no need. Do it. It would have been the simplest job, you see. Anybody could have done it. Because there are complications and problems that somebody has to work through. So there's nothing to feel guilty about it. First thing I have to request today is not to feel guilty about it. So the second center is the second center is of your activity, as I told. So through your activity also you create problems on the central line. Now how do you create that? It's like this, you can say the left and the right, and the center part is the Sushumna. Now these two start working. And if they work very hard or they pull each other on the side, then sometimes it may be dislocation completely, by which you lose your complete connection with the whole. Or could be that it may narrow down, the path may narrow down. And sometimes it can be very much injured or sick. These centers could be very sick. Before we discuss about the deities on these centers, I would like to say that all these powers, these three powers, get enlightened after your realization. Before your realization, there is no enlightenment. For example, the left-hand side power is the power of desire. First of all, your priorities start changing. Say, a person wants to buy a very comfortable car like Rolls Royce, for example, he dreams, I must have a Rolls Royce, I must have a nice Rolls Royce to go. But after realization, he doesn't like much these things. The reason is, he starts feeling the comfort of Rolls Royce within himself. He forgets about all these things. His attention does not go to these things which look apparently very comfortable. They are not. If you see to the scrutinize, say for example, take the question of clothes. It's a headache to have such a so-called comfortable car, because somebody might be steal, you have to have insurance people might have a loophole somewhere, you may lose the money. If something happens to the car, you are so much worried. While you are driving, you are so much worried, somebody bumps into your car and you think, oh, such a nice car. I mean, it's a headache to possess a Rolls Royce. It's better that somebody has it and you enjoy it. But if but if you own it and if you possess it, then you go to this registration office to register it there and this and that. And it's a big headache. And the worst of all is that people are jealous of it. They don't like you. They don't like you because you have got a... I mean, what is the advantage of having a Rolls Royce car? But then, that it is so many disadvantages. Plus, I mean, on the one side only you can say, I don't know which one, what should I say, what is the advantage? Maybe that, I mean, it's a good car, reliable car and all that could be there, quality-wise, all that there. But for that, how much you have to sacrifice and how much you have to work? So, to possess something, the idea of possession becomes different. Then you want to possess these cool vibrations, you see, want to possess that. Because you get really fed of other possessions. And you start seeing that this is what gives you the greatest comfort and possession. You start just changing your desires about things. The second desire is about, say, some people want to have a good family life, and for that they strive, and there are Romeos and Juliets and this and that, all kinds of things, crying and weeping, and all thing goes on, and the husband doesn't carry on with the wife, and the wife doesn't carry on with the husband, and then they feel very hurt, and all those things happen. That same thing. That you think that you can get happiness from your wife. Is that simply wrong, right? Can never get happiness from anybody else but from yourself. The joy comes from your spirit, not from anybody else. Now, supposing a Sahaja Yogi has married a person who is not a Sahaja Yogi. It's a wonderful study. You can study a person so closely who is not a Sahaja Yogi, how he is prankish, how he goes into tantrums, and how he behaves. You get a regular sort of a role being played by someone, you start seeing the whole drama much better. Suppose he is a Sahaja Yogi, maybe a little insipid, because there won't be any problem or quarrel. But you see, then you see the person, how he behaves, and how he... Then you understand. You understand that why people behave like this. And what we have to do, what are the problems, and how to make the arrangements by which these people stop going into these holes and getting stuck up into things. You see, you start studying. When you start studying like that, not getting angry and impatient with the person who is your partner, then you will start enjoying. But if you start getting impatient, in the beginning many Sahaja Yogis do feel impatient with their partners because they are not Sahaja Yogis. They think that these people are lost now, what will they do, when are they going to get their realization and all that. Instead of that, if you really develop properly, if you grow properly, you start seeing it in a different angle. Oh, that's the way they are. You see, then you start generalizing all this. Then you do not say, this is my wife, she should have it. This is my wife. You know, some people think because somebody is your wife, she should be a perfect person. And because she's your wife. And what are you? Are you perfect? I mean, why do you expect your wife to be that perfect? If she has kept one thing here or there, or he, I mean, it can be anyway, I mean, he or she does not matter. Whosoever has done so-called mistakes, see, actually, it comes because you think you are absolutely perfect on top of the world, you see? And that's why you try to find fault with another person. But when you are such a yogi, you realize that you have to grow, you have to mature. And how can you find fault with people like that? Only thing you can do is to study the whole thing, because the whole thing becomes a drama. How big you become? You start seeing the whole thing as a drama. And it doesn't behave the way you want things to behave, that these circumstances sometimes engulf you, and you can become sad. I see here people, you see, because the husband came late, so wife hit the husband and killed him or something like that. But see how funny. She was angry with him, he came late, or whatever he did was because he did not love her. She felt that it was due that he should love. And to love, should you kill the husband? Then who is going to love him? See, this kind of thing, you see, start seeing these very, I should say, paradoxical behavior of people. They are so paradoxical. And the whole thing becomes so apparent and so vivid when you start seeing it through your spirit. Because you are not in it. You are yourself. You are not now the husband or wife or anything. But you see yourself as a husband and another person or a wife, or you see yourself as a wife and another person as a husband. And it's a very different thing, and then the whole thing becomes such a drama and such a beautiful poetry that you start seeing, you feel that, oh, the whole Shakespeare is coming before you, or whatever. Most dramatic thing is happening to you. So this is another thing that our desires change, that you see, I want a peaceful life, you see, but the peace is within. Peace is not outside. If you are not peaceful inside, you cannot be peaceful outside. Anybody who is seeing you will know that you are not at all peaceful within. You have to find your own peace, your own peace. And if you want to have that, it is you who has to receive this blessing, and it is you who has to enjoy it. So no use blaming anybody else by saying that, oh, I'm so unhappy, and this was, she was not making this much noise, or I felt very disturbed. Then you don't feel it. Actually, after the realization, you'll be surprised, all these over-sensitive things to sounds and noises and all that, that is because you can tell your silence. Let the people shout, scream, who are in your silence zone, and you start seeing it. And sometimes you also think that they are shouting at somebody who is just gone here. The whole priorities of your desires start changing because you start enjoying stuff. For example, to a child who has never eaten ice cream and has just taken, say, only milk all his life. If you give him ice cream, then he shifts his attention to ice cream much more than to milk. In the same way, once you test or you get the nectar of your spiritual bliss pouring into you, the ideas that are built up about your desires all start collapsing. And what you find, a new sort of a personality comes in you, and you start desiring something else. For example, an egg may be desiring something which the bird does not. Bird has different desires, and an egg has different desires. In the same way, it happens to us when we change our state, when we are in a different situation as far as our spirit is concerned, then all our desires take a different turn and we become different. Like our many habits that we have because of our conditioning and things. Now people have so many habits that sometimes I really surprised how people boast of their habits. Like a lady came to me and she bored me stiff by telling me, oh, you know, I can't take milk with any cream on. If I see cream, I want it. I said, this is too much for me, I know. Wow, how far am I going? Mad. Then she came out with something else, you know, I am so particular about this. And in my bed, if there's even one line, I can't sleep. Then how does she exist? It's like, she's a mad woman. Said that she can't bear this, she can't bear that, she's so finicky and so funny. I said, how people must be living with her, must be another problem, the way she is. And she really bored me stiff, and I didn't know what to tell her. But then I just said to her, but your husband is so normal, what's the matter with you? She said, he's different. I'm different. I said, you better become like him, because it's too much. I don't know how he bears you up, but it's too much. And really the thing was, her husband was a real asshole and she was not. And he just took, saw her like that, she was, he must be laughing at her, the way she was fussy about wanting, I can't bear this, I won't have this, I won't have this, I am such and such, I am such and such. All these ideas about yourselves also come to you from your conditioning. For example, an Englishman thinks he's an Englishman, you see, something upper left. Then if you take an American, he thinks he's very rich and he's very fast and he boasts of his fastness, you see. Sometimes they boast so much that it's amazing the way they go about their speediness, you see, the way they are speeding. Then a German will boast of his over-meticulous efficiency or something like that. An Indian will boast of his ritualism and all nonsense that they do around. All sorts of things like that you find if you need. The proud of, see, to belonging to certain nation is all right, it's very good, you should be proud of your nation, but of good things and not of bad things. Now, all such a conditioning that I am an Englishman, I am an Indian, I am this and that, all such, because these are demarcations created by human beings. I mean, God just created a beautiful man. He had to put some rivers after all, you see, he had to put some mountains somewhere, he had to do all these things. He never asked you to get yourself divided, I am this, I am that, I am that. We ourselves have done all these nonsense. I mean, think from what point of view. He must be wondering what's the matter with these people. We have to have immigration, we have to have things to go to some country, we have to get a pass, we have to have a visa, we have to have this. Why? Because we are ourselves like that. We are ourselves are so greedy, so selfish, everything is together. And that's how all human beings against God, if you see, that he must be wondering what's the matter with these people. I have given them such a beautiful thing to enjoy themselves. Why don't they enjoy instead of that every time they work on the energy of hatred, how to create hatred, and all these different things are your conditionings are based. We can say about art and everything, also our conditionings are based according to what we have been seeing. If somebody has been seeing the white color more or a gray color more, they'll always like it. If they have seen red all the time, they like it. It's only a question of conditioning. It's not a question of your innate some sort of a spiritual thing. Do not confuse spirit with these material aspirations. Or the material ideas there. It's not. Spirit is beyond, it's that. It has nothing to do with what race, creed you go into. It is not bothered about what things you think beautiful, what things you don't. Because it is absolute. It's not relative. It's absolute. When you see through your vibrations, you'll be amazed that certain things, whether they are Indian, English or anything, you will not like. Certain things, they may be anything. This absolute is a coefficient worked out by God's mathematics, not by human mathematics. And if that works out, then only you are going to like it because you like the vibration. Ultimately you like the vibration. The things that do not give you good vibrations, you are not going to have. I'll give you an example. Supposing there's a chair. It is being sat on by some lazy person. Any surgeon will come there, he has just touch the chair and get out and walk and sit on the other side. Because he'll see, immediately feel the vibration and he's not going to sit with that. Just now she told me about her daughter that one magician came and my daughter, who is a real life soul, she said that he's a very funny man and I don't like him start to speak. Even a child can feel absolute. Everything becomes absolute. Not because somebody has a blonde hair or somebody has a blue eyes or a red lips or anything, but it is the whole of it. It is the coefficients of that personality that gives those vibrations which people are going to enjoy and are going to feel. And that is what that is going to appeal to them. So the whole idea of our color schemes, of our art, of our aesthetics, only God's aesthetics are working out in us. We don't like anything. That is not divine. That's not anything divine. Even food, everybody will give vibrations to the food. Everything that they desire. For example, now, I mean, people who are bad livers, for example, say in London is a common disease of bad livers. It's an absolutely liver, surprisingly. And the worst is Europe. And Europe is the liver of the universe, and where the liver is so bad. And the first question they ask me, mother, what is to be done about awareness and about liver? I said, what? Why is it so bad? Because Europe is the liver of the universe, and we are Europeans, and we drink all through, and what are we to do now? I said, now you have a sick liver, for the whole universe will have a sick liver. So be careful about it. You have to work it out. And then they wrote it down, what is to be done, and they said, they got it. What to eat? This is important, because they felt not that they should keep their livers all right, but they should get the liver of all the Europeans. Because if the Europeans have bad livers, God himself is going to have a bad liver problem. See, the whole idea changes because you start translating your ideas in relation to the whole. And when you start thinking of the whole that, oh God, by me this is going to be caused, by this everybody is going to suffer, and naturally, not mentally so much, as to vibration, you start to. I have seen people that when I told them that you should not eat this, and I was religious, I tell you, no doctor would have had such obedience as I have. But I don't even tell that religiously, and I don't tell them that scientifically or in any way, but they just start doing it because they don't know to use their vibration. If you have a bad liver, you get very hot vibration. Are you getting now? So this is what happens. This is the liver that gives you heat, and this liver must be cured, because if liver is bad, you can get cirrhosis, you can get this, you can get that. Lots of problems can come in and you will be in trouble, and you start understanding your own value, the value of your health, more than material things. It doesn't matter if you have one dress less or one house less, doesn't matter. First of all, this body should be all right. And that is how the desire to have a healthy body moves. In a proper way, that you should have a proper body, that should be the temple. Same thing about your thoughts. Start cleaning them, start seeing them, and you start understanding why these thoughts are coming to me. From where are they coming? These thoughts are not good. They do not give me any nourishment. They are very exasperating and retarding. So you start working on that. You start making your mind cooling down, your mind, and making your mind still, and going into thoughtless awareness, so that you have a tranquil feeling, which is so good, which is so nice. Everybody wants tranquility. I mean, if you can achieve it through your spiritual growth, why? Then the best part of it, that you start seeing your ego and super. That's the best part. When you start seeing your ego like a big balloon is shutting out like that, oh God. And then you say, mother, this is so much, I've never seen such a bad ego. No, it doesn't matter, it comes down. So they work on their ego, then they start seeing it, and they say, oh mother, this was my ego. Once you start seeing it, it goes. You cannot enjoy life if you have the ego. Ego is the thing that kills you completely. It will make you a spoiled. It's a spoiled sporting stuff. See, it always gives you joy if it is pampered. And the pampering of it comes by spoiling the sport. The sport of the divine. Such a person is an aggressor out and out, and is a problem to everyone, and people don't know what to do. Everybody will know that he's too much aggressive, but they will not. But aggressor is the same as a person who takes aggression, I feel. The one who takes aggression hurts himself. Why should you hurt yourself? God has made this body so beautiful, with such care, with such love. He's raised it from amoeba to this stage. And have you decided to destroy it? this beautiful body, why do you want to destroy it? Why do you want to hurt? So the superego also starts getting reduced. It starts saying, no, I don't want to do it. I don't want to play into the hands of negativity by which I become a useless temple. Superego people sometimes, you see, have an idea, oh, that if we are very frightened of everyone, we are very good. Because Christ has said, blessed are those. That's something different, very different. To be seen in very different lines, which I'll explain to you later on. But the way people have interpreted it, that if you become very mild and non-aggressive, then you are a very nice. I mean, I don't say that you should be aggressive. I mean, again, the other side should be seen. I talked of ego first, so that you don't become aggressive. But the thing is, to be even non-aggressive is all right, but we can say that to take aggression upon you is also very wrong. One should never take any aggression. I would say Hitler would never have been successful if at that time, from the very beginning, you would have resisted. But they allowed. They allowed them to take advantage. Gradually, it grew up. Anywhere there is an operation like that coming up, everybody must stand against it. It's a very difficult point. Few people take aggression, then more people take aggression, you see. And those who go and patronize, oh, it's all right. It's never all right. It grows and grows and grows. And this point then comes up. Like such a controlling force that the whole world could not control this Germany to save these people who were killed so helplessly. But they first showed their helplessness in the very beginning, at the very corner, where somebody tells that you should stand up and say, no, it's not. So both the things are responsible for this kind of an event. I would blame Jews the same way as I would blame Hitler and Germans. Because why did the Jews suffer so much? Begin. Now when they are free, they have got a land, they are behaving in a different way. That time if they all would have stood up and said, nothing doing, we are not going to stand all this nonsense. They could have taken help from other countries and would have saved those people. That's what it is. You see, we are sufferers. Go ahead with the suffering then. We must suffer. Why should we suffer? Christ has suffered for you. Already suffered. You don't have to suffer. You are not here to suffer. You are here to be happy. To be dressed in His love. Not to suffer. Why do you want to suffer? I mean, this is crucifixion for nothing at all. You are not needed for any more crucifixion. But these things can create a big problem. I must say, this kind of witnessing of growth of these negative people, these aggressive people, this silent witnessing, this sin. One should not allow this kind of a thing to come up. Hatred that is developing anywhere, in any country, any place is wrong. Like in our country, India. You think Indians are not like that? They are also quite horrible. In our country also we have untouchables and touchables. But Mahatma Gandhi came and laughed at them. He said, what do you mean by touchables and untouchables? And he taught me that it was removed. He himself was not from the same community as untouchables. But there was a fellow from untouchables also, who was a very great doctor of America, who fought it. He said, nothing going, we don't believe in all this. In the same way, we have to know whether we belong to the oppressed or to the oppressor group, so-called. We should stand by people who are oppressed, and we should really flout all such ideas, because it's very dangerous. So it happens that you stand against all kinds of injustice, unfairly. You get the courage, like Christ,
What has he got to do with Mari Bhaktarini? She was a prostitute. Prostitute has nothing to do with the sect as such. But when he saw that she was stolen by these people, out of proportion she was punished for what? He was the one who went and stood before her. That courage comes to you through your spiritual growth. And you stand by the right. Stand by the people who are oppressed. You just don't take anything in. That those ideas of bearing up and all that nonsense is gone. As it is, Christ has said that if somebody slaps you on one face, you turn the other. It was at the time of Romans one had to say that. For egoistic people, it is better practice. All those ego-oriented people, most of the Christian nations, you can say, are that. For them is a good practice that if somebody slaps on one face, you turn the other. But the people who are suppressed are, those say, we can say people who are living in the most. They are great because they really realize so. That weakness should get spontaneous. Because it is within you to grow to that. You suddenly grow when the seed of your spirit grows. And you are amazed at your great idea. And you are transcending attention and awareness. So this is what it happens to you. You desire it. Because you don't desire nonsense. That's what I say. And you desire and you get it. You just desire what you have. Whatever you want, just ask for it. You'll have. But first, we have to enlist ourselves into the kingdom. You have to become a citizen. If I am not the citizen of England, I cannot get the benefits of English law. If you are not the citizen of God's kingdom, you do not get the benefits. He has got his own telecommunication. He has got everything you won't believe. And the way he works it out is so tremendous. It is so magnificent. It's so miraculous that then you start saying that all this we have known so far is falsehood and this is the truth which we should achieve. We should establish, mature ourselves and enjoy. It's just for your enjoyment that your bias come on and follow me. They have talked to you on one side, tomorrow, next time when I come, I'll tell you on the other side. I hope in the center the yoga will work out and it will grow into a big organization, even living organization. It does not have any membership, no payment, nothing. It's a living. And the people will be attracted because of the love that they feel for each other and because of the love they feel for themselves. Vibrations, it's pure vibrations of divine love. Once you get that, you don't want to part. You just don't want to part. That's so beautiful. May God. Now, have you any questions today? You better now. I'm working. Let's have some questions. It would be a good idea. Questions, please.
rather difficult.
Better ask me questions. But trouble is, the Kundalini has risen about this. Then you are in thoughtless awareness and don't want to then go into thought. Think over it. If you can't think of a problem or a question. Yeah, finish the one. Ek kurche. Baki aa gaya tha. Us paru se le lo. Basta. Aaye ka kurche ki tarah se chala. Kurche se is mein se. Now today we have in our presence Mr. Pradhan, who is now 76. And he came to me about 12 years back or 11 years back. He belongs to the first batch of Sahaja. And I worked on them, about 25 of them, for 2 years. And after 2 years, only 12 of them got realization. After 2 years, can you believe it? He's one of them. And he's now going to America, because I've been going to America, so he wants to work and pave way for me. He's come all the way from India. He's a lawyer, he's an advocate, and he has had a very great understanding of Sahaja Yoga. He's helped me a lot. Last time I went to America also, he came down. And he is our trustee. We had to have a trust in India. You cannot even get a hall without a trust. So we had a trust. And, today there's a good news that somebody has given us donation of 1 acre of land in Powai Lake area, which is a very beautiful area, in addition to what that news. So I don't know, maybe that people want to now have places where they could come and maybe stay and sit down. So it's little far away from Bombay, about say, I think about 8 miles or so. It's a very, very quiet area, very quiet area. There are 2 lakes there. It's a very nice place. And today only I received the message saying that somebody has donated us. I was very happy that they have donated us, because we could not buy any land, because I said that we will not give any black money or any bribery or anything, and the land has to be in proper price. We will not give extra money, because it's public money. But somehow or other, now we bought some land there. Now I would request one of the Sahaja Yogis to say a few words about Mr. Pradhan, and then Mr. Pradhan will speak to you how Indian Sahaja Yogis have been to these people when they went to India, and how they treated them, and how they were kind. And then Mr. Pradhan will just say a few things. And Ravin, would you like to say a few words, or anyone who has been to India? Anyone? Yeah. About two sentences, and Pradhan will say about his, because now he will be able to tell you what experiences he has. He's an advocate, and he'll tell you some miraculous experiences he has had after Sahaja Yoga. Let's see.
So what I said will be a little bit certified.
Mr. Pradhan, it's a great pleasure for us to receive you here and to be able to welcome you.
And Mrs. Pradhan is also with him.
Mrs. Pradhan is also here. We owe a great deal to Bombay Sadhu Yogis, and especially to those senior ones who've looked after us on many visits now. Personally, I've been with my wife twice to India, and both times we've been most generously and hospitably looked after. It's quite a different style from the kind of hospitality we offer here. It's a good deal more giving and more complete. Really everything is seen to.
Mr. Pradhan is such a quiet, unassuming personality. One doesn't realize what a tremendous work he has done on the administrative side in establishing Sahaja Yoga in Bombay. I know he's had a number of really remarkable experiences in Sahaja Yoga, and I hope he'll speak about those afterwards. Just like to thank him for coming to our country and wish him every success on the trip to America, which I'm sure is going to be a very important stage in the spreading of Sahaja Yoga. And I know Mr. Pradhan will quietly and efficiently set the scene for Masjid going in September. We have something to present on behalf of Sahaja Yogis.
Okay. Let him speak first of all.
We'll do after.
This is my eldest son now. One we had who was 98 year old in Baroda Satyasana. I had 10 over Satyasana. He was 3 years old. He was 3 years old. And this gentleman is no more now, this 98 year old gentleman. But now he's the eldest one.
I am Mr. Thanks Gavin for speaking very good words about me. In the first place, a great pleasure to meet our London Sahaja Yogis here, because I have been at the lotus feet of Mataji for the last 12 years. I am an advocate practicing lawyer and give a number of instances about experience about my experience about this, how the Divine Mother's powers we can achieve a great deal by having a self-realization at the feet of our Divine Mother. You see, our Divine Mother Mataji has discovered this Sahaja Yoga. This is a unique Sahaja Yoga by which we have seen that thousands of people get self-realization, irrespective of caste, creed, or religion. As explained by Mataji, I think already, Sahaja means born with you, inner and spontaneous. Now, about my experience, I'll tell you, when you become self-realized, you become careless, you get sound sleep, that is my experience, and whatever work you do, you do it with great concentration and in a very good manner. You see, the power of our Mataji the Divine Mother, our visitant. I have a personal experience. I am a lawyer practicing Bombay High Court. See, you'll be surprised to find the miracle about one matter. In matters in Sampudi. You see, I had one appeal in Bombay High Court. It was a second appeal from Mukil. And that matter came up before His Lordship Justice Knight. As usual, my matter, the appeal, was 15th of Goa. That was Friday, I remember very much that was Friday. I thought generally only four or five matters are taken up by His Lordship every day. And Saturday and Sunday being holidays, I was quite sure that my appeal won't reach hearing at least before Tuesday. So I was on that particular day, I was very busy because I'm a trustee of our Mataji's Life Eternal Trust. And at his residence, I was doing some work. So I was quite sure that the matter won't reach. And throughout the whole day, I was at Mataji's residence. On that day, the Saturday and Sunday being holidays, I had called my client to see me in Bombay and to attend the court. But my client came very late. He came to my residence on Sunday and inquired as to what happened about my appeal. Then I told him, please wait, I'll let you know. I phoned the advocate for the other side, that is the counsel for the other side, and inquired as to what has happened about the matter, whether it has reached or it is pending. He said, what? Are you befooling me? What happened? He said, Pradhan, the matter was argued by you. The matter was disposed of on Friday. I was surprised. Actually, the whole brief was lying at my table at my residence. Something has happened. Then I kept quiet. I said, very well. I got some misunderstanding about some other matter. Then I told my client, better see me on Monday in the High Court. Then on Monday, I went to High Court. I inquired from the judicial clerk there as to what happened about this matter, which was 15th on the board. He said, Mr. Pradhan, you are there. The matter was argued on that day. On that day, what happened? Some four or five matters were adjourned. Two, three matters were compromised. So your matter reached at about 4:30. So, and it is this one now. Still, however, I was not sure. Generally, the judges, the stenographer, the judges, they type the judgment. And the judgment was signed after 2-3 days. So when the judgment was received by the office, I went to the office of the High Court and I saw the judgment exactly dictated by His Lordship. And in that particular judgment, my name was mentioned thrice. Mr. Pradhan has argued this point of limitation and I appreciate that. Mr. Pradhan has argued this point of about something. And Mr. Pradhan thrice has mentioned, His Lordship has mentioned my name thrice. The tears came from my eyes. I said, this is Mataji's power. I was not bodily, I was not present there. And who went there and argued appeal? So in the evening, I went to Mataji's residence. And I told Mataji, this miracle happened. So what happened? So Mataji laughed to heart's content. I said, now Mr. Pradhan, you are busy at our residence. The Adi Shakti went there, argued the matter, what was in your brain? I said, you are so many things. See, there was one Sahajogi, he was my relative, he was my metal arm son. He was also a lawyer from Baroda, a big city in India. He had become self-realized at the age of 98. And when Mataji had come to Baroda from Bombay, as we had some centers there, this gentleman, 98 years, he climbed two floors. There was no lift. And he came there. Mataji was surprised to find himself climbing quite upright. She will be surprised to find.
He came on a stretcher, actually.
He came on a stretcher
and just to come up, he walked up nicely. They were all surprised that he got up and started walking up.
He says some fragrance is coming. I don't know if he says some fragrance is coming.
So I got some fragrance, I got up and started walking.
Yeah, I got up and started walking. So, all of you should get realization. Because I've seen that. We are in Bombay, we have thousands of people like Kashi. We are doing a good thing in Bombay. We have our center, total center. And our London service is also, they have come to Bombay. And they have helped us a lot. See, according to me, I have done little to assure the cause of our Mataji's Sahaja. Whatever I might have done by the power of Mataji. One thing is certain, see, when you become self-realized, you are helpful to it. See, look at my age, but look at me. You will be surprised to find that I am running 77. But still, Mataji says, look at Mr. Pradhan, he is working like a young man. But that is Mataji's grace, so I have done so many things.
And he is going to America. That's the best part of it. To help the Americans with the Sahaja Yoga. Let's see how many young Sahaja Yogis are going to come.
See, whatever work I take, Mataji work, I do it so easily. Spontaneously, it happens spontaneously. See, I am one of the senior most Sahaja Yoga Mataji, on the trustee also. We have to build an ashram there, and we are collecting donations, because we require donations for, we have to build some ashrams at Bombay, Pune, Delhi. So we are also appealing people to help us. And for this very good cause, and carry out Mataji's mission to its end. See, may God give us the same love and temperament like our Mataji to help our Sahayogi, to bring them to self-realization, to help our continent, to get them self-realization.
Our
Mata is so simple. I see that when we go to the countryside and when we are on the seashore, I see among the ladies on the seashore, you sleep under the tree on the sands. I have seen that. She is not particular about any place or in some bungalow or something like that. Similarly, she is a trustee. Mataji never cares to look at the account. She doesn't say, Mr. Mataji, you can go, you are trustee. She doesn't care what money you have received, what money you have spent. She is very human in nature. And you will be surprised to find that Mataji is so sincere in her work. But I see now that she is not taking lunch even till 3:38 in the afternoon. She then somebody reminds Mataji, I will come to the bath, then she will get up and have a lunch. Mr. Kesangan?
I'm telling him to tell about the experiences of Sahaja Yoga, how he grew up. See, this is the point. is that how one should grow. I think he has grown himself.
You see, one thing is certain. When you become self-realized, you must go on, carry on your meditation every day. You must stick up to this scenario. You should not give it up. You must stick it and carry on.
Kolhapur Dharma Sangha, how you say it? Kolhapur Dharma. You see how negativity affects, how affected him, and how he should understand how to continue with Sahaja Yoga, despite all negativity, how to overcome. Kolhapur Dharma, you
should study.
You see, small things, when I tell people that don't do this, they feel very hurt. But he has found out from his experience that whatever I say, there's some sort of a danger that I say don't do.
You see, I'll tell you one experience, particular experience. You see, Mataji has given us power, purity power. By self-realization, you can cure so many people. So what happened in Kolhapur city, there is a big city in Kolhapur, in Bombay province. So we had a very good program there. About 1,000 people were assembled from all the villages. At that time, the hall was full, and it was my duty to see it go around and see that all the people are doing well. They are well seated. So what happened, there was only one door, in the door. At the corner of the entrance door, there was some small crowd, one old lady was crying. Mataji was quite busy with her work, giving vibrations to hundreds of people. So that lady was crying. I said, my son, youngest son, about 20, 22 years, he became unconscious. As soon as he entered the hall, he became unconscious. Then I gave him purity. I cured him by doing the hour, by doing vibrations. Then he got up. The young man got up. I told his mother that please now don't go at the feet of Mataji. There is strong negativity here and you go. But that lady did not listen to me. And when the meditation program was over, everybody was going at the feet of Mataji.
This is just the other way round. In India, if you tell somebody not to touch my feet, then they are very angry. Here, if you tell somebody you have to touch my feet, that person will never appear again. That's the other way round. Because the power flows more from the feet, you see. So that's why those who know will jump there. But those who do not know, if you tell them, then you have it. Better not tell. It's a very different thing. And if you tell in India that nobody has to touch my feet today, because sometimes there are thousands of people, my feet sometimes get swollen up the way they go on touching my feet. But if you tell them, then that's the worst thing. The one who tells them is finished. They don't like such a man. So it's a very different situation.
But Mataji, I get very good vibrations from it when I touch. I get very good vibrations. See, I take the best opportunity to touch Mataji's feet and take vibration, at least pumping the petrol in our body to carry out the car. So that there was a big crowd. That lady brought her son at Mataji's feet. As soon as he touched Mataji's feet, So I was at the near side of Mataji. So Mataji, you see, this fellow had become unconscious and had cured him. Then Mataji looked at me. Oh, you are a man of advance, you have cured him. The strong negativity in his body. You are not affected. Then Mataji took 15 minutes to cure him. Then I was quite all right. My head had become very hot.
He was about to faint himself.
Then he had warned me, Mr. Pradhan, you are a man of advance, don't cure anybody. Because that negativity, it attacks you and it enters your body.
There should be no sympathy. No sympathy. We should take it easy. You see, sympathy should come when you are very strong enough. Otherwise, there's no need to have sympathy with these people. If an attack is so badly, you all will get affected. With one negative person coming in the hall now, supposing somebody comes like that, all will get attacked. See, because dirt and filth can get always attached to you. But to cleanse it is difficult. To get attached, supposing somebody pours, say, some sort of a color, everybody will get the color. but to remove it is difficult. That's what it is. So one has to be very careful about this negativity, no doubt.
And these people, the person with negativity, they always tremble like this, and such person should be removed from the crowd.
Now people have started understanding it. Before they used to think it's not good, we should have everyone there. But you can't just bear. When they come out, you don't know what happens to your people. But I thought they are thanks for the good time.
So, many people have given us courage and love and Lata Mataji to help our continue to raise the Sundarini by Swami Yoga and transform this world full of strife, struggle. And thank you very much for having this presentation. And
okay. Ah. Today, tumchasathi kai gaanlay. Mrs. Pradhan also has been very kind to Sahaj Yoga. So she's not a trustee, but she's made lots of nice poems, and she sings very well now. She's an old lady. And she has looked after people very well. And first of all, Mr. Garland, the book here. This is Mrs. Pradhan. This is the typical Maharashtrian sari that they wear in India, I think. Aha, he. Ali Jayala Sumala Pradhan, Baga. Aha, Lipia. The photograph.
You see today,
because of his trusteeship, yeah.
Oh, thank you very much.
मुख्य अजून दिलेलं नाही तुम्हाला मुख्य देन हॅज गॉन टुगेदर एक मिनिट थांब आय फील व्हेरी प्राऊड ऑफ मिस्टर प्रधान आय विश यू पीपल ऑल ट्राय टू फॉलो हिज एक्झाम्पल तुम्हाला एक लहान किलो काढची फोटो माझा द्यायला
फोटो
माझा देत आहे तुम्हाला मोस्ट पीपल charge of American tour and all that can talk to Pradhan and discuss with him, well, take his address and some more his address and all those people that are there and also get information as to other people's addresses, whichever is needed and how to approach them. Give him the address of also Christine so that he can contact. Just tell him what is done, so that he can not ask him to come to the room. He is still there. And Dr. Raghu has come to the room. So, no, that, to me, that is the presentation moving on. He said, Mother, I'm of a very average intelligence, an average income. I'm nothing outside. And what can I help you? I mean, I'm of no good. Only thing, I'll be getting help out of you. And how will I be of any instrument to you, of any kind of a vehicle for your power? But he has shown with his assiduity and understanding that he himself, so whatever he could do, he has done tremendously. And he daily worked very hard and see to it that things are done properly. He's very efficient, extremely efficient. He's to arrange all of our programs and halls and things and lots of things at this age. Very efficient, always first to arrive, last to leave, organizing everything and looking after everything, extremely humble. It's really remarkable to have such people. It's nice to have somebody with average intelligence than to have too much intelligence, which is a headache, because they never listen. And they have a method of avoiding things and saying, and something, you see, sometimes it was not possible to forget something, do something, he would say, Mother, please forgive me. But he would never argue out the thing. He would just say, please forgive me, I must have forgotten or something might have happened and all. And it was such an easy thing to be with him, because I'm so bad at organizing my things, that I'm so bad at money, you know that. And I never know how to keep accounts, and these people have been organizing money and I have nothing to do with their money. And it's true that I'm very bad at all that. And it is these people who are so sincere and honest that they have looked after this money and they have looked after everything. And that now they have been able to produce this land, and it's very remarkable. But as I would say, this is Sahaja Yoga that has given them all these powers to furnish all these things. And we have created really tremendous people out of Sahaja Yoga, no doubt. May God bless you all, and I hope you all people will also see the blessings of Sahaja Yoga and rise very much in the estimation of God. Yeah.
See, one keynote is that you are total surrender to our Divine One, total surrender. No suspicion in your mind, nothing. Then you get very good in
it. This is all right to say in India, not here. Here really says total surrender, they think we have to surrender our house or car or anything. Ego must be surrendered. What else is to be surrendered? Ego is not you. You have to surrender your ego so that you get rid of that's what it means. But that is understood more in India than here. Because if you say surrender, people will start keeping all your things together. So this is something, you see, an Indian mind is different from a developed mind, and this is how things work out differently. But I must say there are great saints who are born like this. You are on great saints to be born like this. And we are amazed sometimes. These people are amazed the way you are dedicated to science. I mean, the way you have taken to it shows that you are spiritually very much amazed, no doubt about it. I mean, if we are, it's already from childhood we are told we must control our attention, because if you have to attain to God, we must get to God. From childhood we are told this, you have to get to God, you have to achieve your self-realization. I mean, my grandchild was born, and the message that I got from an astrologer, because we always have an astrologer as soon as the child is born. And he sent a telegram saying that the greatest news is that her guru is in the house, and her master, the teacher is in the house. And it was the biggest thing for the whole family, oh, the teacher is in the house, the child doesn't have to go out to see. You see, of course, I mean, this is our traditional way of life in India. But now, of course, we are getting also westernized, quite different. But normally it is so, from childhood it is so. In fact, you have to take your attention to God. Your attention has to go to God. But here to say something, the why for so total surrender? What is the gain? The gain is God. The gain is yourself, is your spirit. But that, once it is instilled in your mind, you think that is the simplest you can do, because the highest you are going to get. So the difference is of understanding. But in any way, quality-wise, I would say you are much better than many Indians put together. No doubt. I think. Especially Indians here, I don't know what they are doing. Okay? I don't know about that. Sorry, we have to, because he's going now, but it won't be any other time. We have to be simple. If you are complicated, then it's difficult. You should be simple. Please close your eyes. Now first what you will feel that there is no thought within you, and then you will start feeling the full breath in the hand. Close your eyes. It's better to close your eyes. But this is just the beginning, this is just the germination. You have to go further with it and you have to grow into it. All those who are getting cool, please raise your hands. Now, all of you, those who are getting cool, please raise your hands. Hi. All the surgeries also, raise your hands, those who are getting cool. All the surgeries also. Now, those who have come for the first time and are not getting cool, please raise your hand. Sare Hindustani bahar kar aao. Abhi ye bhi teen din se aap, teen martaba aaye, char martaba aaye, sara dhyan hai ka? Sara dhyan, naukri, paisa, ye wo, zara chhodiye, ek minute ko sab to chhodiye. Aap to hai. Ye is good. Is good. You felt the cool breeze? Yes. सब बात छोड़िए इस वक्त में उस परमात्मा की ओर चित्त आंखें खोलिए जरा आप भी देखिए Come here. Come. 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 Come